I guess we'll wait for a few more people to turn up. Okay, I think we'll start since it's time. Okay, we'll start with what we were discussing at the end of the lecture last time. Okay. So I'll share my slides. Okay, there you go. So we were talking about arithmetic operators and how you can write complicated expressions using Python. So when you have multiple operators within the same expression, suppose you have an expression like 4 plus 3 minus 5 or something like that, how do you evaluate an expression involving such multiple operations? And this involves a concept of this involves a couple of concepts. One of the most important one is precedence. The evaluation of an expression involving multiple operators is based on precedence. Now, the most helpful rule to remember is to remember that parentheses or brackets have the highest precedence, and everything else can be written in terms of, in case of any confusion, you can always use extra parentheses. So, precedence order, for a few operators is going, we'll discuss it right next. So I guess more people are coming. Okay. So in order to know the exact precedence of all the operators in Python, you can consult a textbook or online documentation. But just for a few examples, here are a few operations. So in the table, the operators with the least precedence are at the end, at the bottom of the table, and the operators with higher and higher precedences occur at the top of the table. Okay. So what does lower precedence mean? Lower precedence means that those operators are done at the end, if possible, and the operators at the higher precedence are evaluated first. Okay, so the highest precedence operators is of course the parenthesis. After that, you have unary plus and minus. Then you have multiply, divide, remainder, and integer division, and so on. And then you have addition, and then comparison operators like less than and greater than, followed by equal to and not equal to. Just remember that in Python, equal to involves two separate equal to signs, and not equal to is an exclamation followed by an equal to. And the last operation is the assignment operator, which is just a single equal sign. Okay. Okay, so if you have a complicated expression like x equal to minus 5 star 4 and so on, so here is an expression, and what you can do is go back to the expression table, the precedence table, and see which is the which is the highest precedence operator. So for example, the unary minus sign operation, okay, it seems a few people are not able to log in. Well, okay, so how do you parse such an expression? So you can see, for example, that minus 5, the unary minus symbol has the highest precedence. So minus 5 is evaluated first. And then you have a choice. You have multiplication and integer division. So among them, they have the same precedence. So the operator that appears first will be evaluated. So you have minus 5 times 4. And then you have integer division and multiplication and so on. So you, whenever there is a choice between multiple operations to evaluate, you evaluate the one with the highest precedence first. Okay, so if you carefully evaluate this, you will get an answer like minus 32. Such expressions are highly discouraged. Always use parentheses to define precedence, and this is safer as a programming practice, and it's also easier for other people to read. Avoid relying on operator precedence to evaluate your expressions. It can give absurd results if you don't use it correctly. Okay, absurd in the sense that the result is always well defined, but it may not be what you want. And whenever you want to refer to a meeting, to an expression or something of that sort, please consult online documentation, online Python documentation, or maybe a textbook to see how exactly the operator precedence works. Okay. So, Okay, now let's go to more sophisticated Python expressions, and we'll slowly introduce what are called if conditions and loops, which are the basic building blocks for simple Python programs, and then we'll move on to functions and so on. So right now, one of the basic requirements for a Python a program to have is what are called conditional expressions. And what is a conditional expression? It's an expression that evaluates to either true or false. These are also called Boolean expressions because the results can be Boolean values like true and false. In order to build or make conditional expressions, what you use is something called relational operators. So these can be used to compare two quantities. And the most common relational operators in Python are greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, and so on. Okay. So you can compare various objects or values in Python, and the result, if the expression is correct, it will always be a true or a false. So if you ask for 3 greater than 2, it will say true. 3 greater than 3 will say false. Similarly, you can compare characters, strings, and so on. You can compare strings. Python does not have single characters as separate entities, not in the usual sense in other languages. Please look at the last example, which is 1.0 equal to 1. And this happens to be true, but in general, please avoid writing mixed expressions in your program which compares integers with real numbers. So this may be true, may not be true. I mean, the rules are precisely defined for it, but the rules are intricate. And in general, only compare integers with integers and real numbers with real numbers. And we'll see how to compare real numbers with real numbers in coming slides. So avoid mixing int and float values while comparing. And comparison of floats is not exact. Okay, it is exact according to some algorithm, but that's not what a normal programmer would expect. Now, again, how do you build more sophisticated conditional expressions? You may want to say that your expression is built up of multiple relational expressions. You want to say that this condition is true and something else is true and so on. So Python provides 3 operations, operators which can be used to build longer and longer, more sophisticated conditional expressions. So these, the logical operators that Python provides are AND, OR, and NOT. AND is a logical AND, which is short-circuited. We will explain what that is right now. OR is the logical OR. So if you have condition 1 or condition 2, then the resulting expression is true if either one of them is true or if both of them is true. NOT is the negation, which is the logical NOT. So if the condition is false, then NOT of that condition is true, and so on. So in order to precisely describe the operation of these operators, we can say that suppose you have an expression E1 and E2, and E1 is false and E2 is false, then E1 and E2 is false, E1 or E2 is false, and so on. If E1 is false and E2 is true, then their AND is false, OR is true. If E1 is true, E2 is false, then AND is false and OR is true. If both are true, then both AND and OR are true. So AND is true if and only if either E1 or E2 or both. If at least one of them is true, then the result is true. And if both of them are false, then the entire condition is false. Similarly, if you have E and not E, so whenever E is false, not of E is true. Whenever E is true, and not a fee is false. So this describes how you can build logical expressions using conditional expressions using logical operators and relational expressions. So for example, you can create very complex expressions of the form below. For example, below, you can say if X is a variable, I can say X plus 7 is greater than 93 and not Y plus 3 is less than Z. And or absolute value of square root of W minus G is less than epsilon and so on. So using and, not, or, and using the relational operators, you can build more and more complicated conditional expressions, which you may encounter while programming. So these expressions can involve variables, constants, and later on we will say function names and so on. Okay, so now once we have conditional expressions, that is expressions which can evaluate true and false, we are now at a point where we can write more sophisticated programs. For that, we'll introduce conditional statements in Python. So in normal life, we may have statements like, if it's very hot, then I'll skip gym today. Or if I'll say that if there is a quiz tomorrow, I'll first study and then sleep. Otherwise, I'll sleep now and so on. Similarly, I can say that if I have to buy coffee, then I'll go left. Otherwise, I'll go straight. So often in life, we have a decision to make. And based on a certain condition, we'll take a certain decision. And if the condition is false, we may take some other decision. Okay, so how do we do this in a programming language? So let's look at two examples. First will be a very simple example, and the next example will be a more complicated example based on just building on the simple example. Okay, so first the simple example. Let's compare two integers and print the smaller of the two. Okay, so let's say that I have two values, x and y. Let's say x equal to 6 and y equal to 10. And say something like, if x is less than y, colon, print x, else print y. Okay. If x is less than y, then clearly x is the minimum value, so you print x. Otherwise, you print y. Okay. Now, there are a few conditions, a few things to notice here. If you look at if x less than y, colon, so the x less than y part is essentially a conditional expression, what we have discussed right now. And then you have a colon sign, which says that if this condition is true, then do what follows, okay, which is print x. Else, that means the preceding condition is false. So else colon print y, because that's the alternative decision. Okay. Now, let's see how this works. So let's say that x equal to 6 and y equal to 10. If x less than y, print x, else print y. And then finally, print is the min. Okay, so let's go through this step by step. The indentation of the program here on this slide is slightly erroneous. Please ignore the mistake right now. So let's say x equal to y is x equal to 6, y equal to 10. And so if x less than y, so what it does is, if 6 is less than 10, you know that 6 is less than 10 will evaluate to true. So the true branch is taken and it will print x. So on the output, you'll say C6. And then you say, okay, should the else branch be taken? But the condition was true, so the else branch will not be taken. And then you say, okay, print is the min. So the output will be printed as 6 is the min. Okay. Indentation is important in Python. So basically, whether you insert a block of statements to the left or to the right will matter in Python. So grouping of a statement or a block of statements is what is called an indentation. And there are no explicit brackets. So people who are used to languages like C or Java or something, you know that you can group a bunch of statements using open curly brace and close curly brace. Python does not have that, fortunately or unfortunately. And and the way to say that these group of statements belong to a particular block is to say that all of them are indented 6 spaces inside or something like that. Okay, so I'll give a example right now. So this is Arrhenius. So if you run the program, x equal to y is 6, x equal to 6, y equal to 10, less than y, then print x, else print y. Okay. So here the indentation is different from in the initial slide. So what happens is that when you say is the min, this earlier this was considered as a statement outside the if else block, but here it will be considered as inside the block. So in that case, the last statement is just skipped. Okay. So in Python, a group of statements is something that shares the same indentation level. And if a statement is kind of outdented out from the remaining state from the preceding statements, then that means that the previous block has entered and we are starting a new block. So we'll see an example in coding, I think. So let's look at Trinket. Okay, so let's look at, so I've coded here what we have seen in the slides, x equal to 6, y equal to 10. If x is less than y, print x, else print y. And then after that, print is the minimum. Okay, so this was the earlier program that we saw. And if you run it, it will say print, it will print 6, and then on the next line, it will print is the minimum. So in this, please notice that print x is indented inside. Similarly, print y is indented inside, whereas print is the minimum is actually outdented out with respect to the previous lines. So this is not part of the preceding block. Now, if you move is the minimum inside the block, so now I've made it the same indentation level as the previous line. So what happens now is that 6 is less than 10, so it will print 6, and then it will entirely skip the else block. Now the statement is the minimum is part of the else block because it has the same indentation level as the previous line. So it will just print 6. Okay, let's just run the program. Yeah. So basically it just runs 6. It just prints 6 and that's it. Okay. Similarly, Python will complain if you don't indent the else part correctly. So if I move the else statement inside, so now if you look at the code, everything is essentially considered part of the if block. And if you try to run the program, then Python will say that this is probably not a valid program. Okay, so it says bad input on line 5. This is because the else. Yeah. This is because the else part is not indented properly. So I hope this is kept in mind. because this is one of the biggest gotchas when you code in Python. The fact that indentation plays such a big role. And often beginner Python mistakes do not really involve the code per se, the logic of the code per se, but it's more involved about it's basically a lot of it is just syntax mistakes coming from the fact that you're not indenting it properly. So please notice this, especially if you're used to some other programming language, because other programming languages are more forgiving when it comes to spacing issues. But Python, you have to indent it properly. Okay, so let's go back to the slides. Indentation is important in Python, and lines which occur together, which are indented in the same, are what Python considers a block. There are no explicit brackets. Okay, so just let's look at a general form of a if statement. So the general form of an if statement looks like if followed by a Boolean expression, followed by a colon, and then an indented S1 and followed by an outdented S2. Okay. So what happens is that if the condition is true, then it executes S1 followed by S2. If the condition is false, then it just moves to the S2 without executing the S1. Okay, now in addition to the if statement, there's also the if else statement, which we saw right now. So it's something like if Boolean expression colon S1 else S2 and then S3. So how does this statement execute? First, you look at the conditional expression, and if the expression is true, then you execute S1. And then you execute S3. S2 is skipped because S2 corresponds to the else part. If the Boolean expression is false, then you execute S2 first, and then you move on to S3. So if the condition is false, S1, S3 is executed. If the condition is true, then S1, S3 is executed. And if the condition is false, then S2, S3 is executed. Okay, now let's try to look at a slightly bigger example, which is finding the minimum of 3 numbers. Okay. Earlier we were looking at the minimum of 2 numbers. So now let's just try to expand the program so that you can find the minimum of more than 2 numbers, let's say 3. So you're given 3 numbers, A, B, and C. First, you compare A and B. If A is less than B, then A could be the minimum. Okay, so you compare A and C. If A is less than C, then the minimum is A. If C is less than A, we already know that A is less than B. If C is less than A, then C has to be the minimum. So you compare A with B. If A is smaller, then you compare A with C. If A is still smaller, then A is the minimum. If C is smaller than A, then in C. If, with respect to the first decision, B was less than A, then you compare B with C. If B is smaller, then B is the minimum, print B. If C is less than B, we already know that in this branch, B is smaller than A, so C is smaller than B, and B is smaller than A, so C is the minimum. Okay, so we have 2 levels of decisions to make, and the second level of decisions will depend on what the result of the first level is. Okay, so now let's try to just look at the program. So each branch, each decision, the diamond symbol that you see in the flowchart, corresponds to an if-then-else statement. So initially you write a skeleton which looks like if A less than B colon and then else colon. Okay, and now more statements will go into that picture. The nested level of decisions will correspond to nested levels in the code. So if A is less than or equal to B, then you have one more comparison to make, which is A less than or equal to C. So if A is less than or equal to C, then you say that A is print minimum equal to A, else print minimum equal to B. Similarly, in the else part of the first decision. So in the else part of the first decision will correspond to B less than A. If B is less than A, then you compare B with C. If B is less than or equal to C, then minimum equal to B, and otherwise minimum equal to C. Okay. So I guess the logic of the program is clear. So you compare two numbers at a time, and depending on the result, you decide, finally you produce the result. Okay. So the important lesson here is the way the code is indented. So please notice that the first level of decision is corresponds to the outermost level of indentation, and the second level of decisions correspond to the inner level of indentation. Okay. So we have used nested if then else statements. So we have seen if then else within other if then elses. So the code earlier had this structure, if A less than B. Within that, there's a block which is if then else, if A less than or equal to C and else. And then you again come out, come back to the outer level of decision, which corresponds to B less than A. And then you say if B less than or equal to C, then do something and else do something else. So we've seen this nested style of if then else, but this can be elegantly expressed in Python using what are called if elif else statements. Okay, because you could have these nested levels of if then else. Instead, I could say if condition one do something S1, elif condition two. That means if condition one is false but condition two is true, then do S2. Then elif condition three means condition one and two are false but condition three is true, then execute S3 and so on. And finally, there may be a last else. So else will correspond to something that you execute when all previous conditions are false. Okay, so in summary, we have seen if statements, if else statements, and depending on your style of programming, you can write nested ifs or this if elif kind of statement. And there are multiple ways to solve the same problem. And what you have to keep in mind are issues of readability, whether you can maintain the code, and runtime efficiency, which is faster code. And issues like readability, you get used to, there are programming style guides that you can see online. Another thing is, as you write more code, you just get used to a certain style of code. And you may prefer certain style of coding. Almost all programmers, for example, prefer the if-elif style of coding rather than these nested if-then-else with multiple levels of if-then-else. If-elif code is just more elegant to read. Okay. So recap, we have seen relational expressions and Boolean expressions. There are logical operators and relational operators with which you can build these Boolean expressions. We have seen different forms of if statements. We have just seen a plain if statement. We have seen if else statements. And we have also seen if elif else statements. Okay. And you can use any of them depending on your style of coding. We will post a few assignment questions, some of which are graded, and we'll also post a list of programming problems that you can solve. They will not be graded, but it should get you familiar with the Python syntax. Please notice that the biggest problem that beginning Python programmers face is with respect to the level of indentation. And please, the level of indentation that Python uses is, in some sense, it's a common sense mechanism. Okay, blocks of statements are indented in a similar way. That's the rule. But if you are unused to this style of coding, please write a few programs and make sure that the programs execute exactly like how you would expect them to behave. Okay, now here is a topic that we mentioned in one of the tables on logical operators, AND, OR, and NOT. We mentioned that AND and OR use something called short circuit evaluation. This is very important to understand how the computation proceeds. The short circuit rule is very simple. If you have logical AND or logical OR, then there are two operations that you there are two expressions that you have to evaluate, the first expression and the second expression. The short circuit rule says that do not evaluate the second operand of a binary logical operator if the result can be deduced from the first operand. Okay, if the information that you get from the first operand is enough to know the result of the entire operation, then don't even look at the second operation. Second expression. This is why it's called a short circuit. This also applies to nested Boolean operators and so on. So let's look at a complicated expression like NOT of 2 greater than 5 and 3 by 0 greater than 1 or 4 by 0 less than 2. Okay, what's special about this expression? We know that 3 by 0 is an invalid expression because it involves a division by 0. And similarly, 4 by 0 is also an invalid operation since it involves a division by 0. So if those expressions are evaluated, then this whole operation will result in a runtime error. Your program will crash. But short circuiting comes to the rescue in this case. So for example, let's see how short circuiting works. The whole expression consists of two big expressions. The first is highlighted in gray, and the second expression is 4 by 0 less than 2. So now let's look at the expression highlighted in gray. Is the information there sufficient to decide the outcome of the OR expression? If the information there is sufficient to define the outcome of the OR expression, then 4 by 0 less than 2 will not be executed. So now let's look at the gray expression. It is not of something. Okay. So now let's look at the light gray portion, which is the inner expression of the not. So it is 2 by 2 greater than 5 and 3 by 0 greater than 1. So the light gray portion is basically an AND expression, which involves two operations, 2 greater than 5 and 3 by 0 greater than 1. So now let's look at, okay, is the first operand there sufficient to determine the outcome of the AND? So 2 greater than 5 is false. Okay, and whenever one of the expressions is false, the whole AND operation will be false. Okay, so 2 greater than 5 is false. So whatever the remaining thing in the AND expression is, the whole thing is going to be false. So what Python will do is to not even look at the second part. So it will not look at 3 by 0 greater than 1. So this is false. And hence the whole AND expression will become false. So hence the 3 by 0 will not be evaluated by short circuiting. not of the and expression will be true, because the whole and expression turned out to be false, so not of that will be true. And now, what is the situation here? You have an or with two operands, and the first operand, the portion highlighted in dark gray or purple or whatever, that has turned out to be true. And we know that for an OR expression, as long as any of the expressions is true, the whole OR expression is going to be true. We already have sufficient information that the first expression in the OR is true. Hence, OR will not look at the, Python will not look at the second expression. So it will just say that the whole expression is true. So hence, this whole expression will be evaluated to true. And 3x0 and 4x0 will not be executed. Okay, so no error will arise. In fact, the whole expression will be true. Let's try to see that in the trinket. Okay, so I'll just take the console and type in the expression that we saw. So, okay, let's go one by one. So, 1 is 2 greater than 5, and 3x0 greater than 1, let's say. So, this turned out to be false. Whereas, if I did 3x0 greater than 1, if short circuiting had not happened and you try to evaluate the second expression, you will have a zero division error. We did not get a zero division error because of the short circuit. Okay, so now let's go back to this expression and type not of this. Okay, so the inner and expression turns out to be false, hence not of that is true. And now let's try or 4x0 greater than 2 or something. Okay, so again short circuiting will come to the rescue here. You know that the first expression is true, hence the second expression is not evaluated. So the whole thing will turn out to be true. Whereas, had you tried to divide 4x0 and then try to compare it with 2, you will get a zero division error. So because of short circuiting, certain expressions are not even looked at, because there is sufficient information from the first operand of whatever expression, there's sufficient information from the first operand to decide the result entirely. So certain expressions are not evaluated, and because of that you may have safe behavior. So understanding short circuiting is important to understand Boolean expressions. So this is what is called short circuit evaluation. Now, okay, so we have seen that there are three, whenever you have complicated expressions, there are three kinds of rules to decide what happens. One is precedence, and this is applied when you have multiple operators, different operators. Another is called associativity. This is when you have, you know, a bunch of addition symbols occurring together. It says, associativity says whether you start evaluating from the left and start going to the right, or whether you start from the right and go towards the left. Okay. And a precedence and associativity identify the order in which the operation is executed. Python evaluates expressions from left to right. While evaluating an assignment, the right-hand side is evaluated before going to the left-hand side. This is because, for example, assignment operation deliberately has the least precedence. So in a complicated expression, when you have an assignment symbol, it will be done at the end. Okay. So you have precedence, associativity, and the left to right order in which Python reads expressions. So these are the three important concepts used to understand how Python looks at expressions and evaluates them. Okay, now for one particular subtle point. Earlier I said that please be careful when you deal with real numbers in Python. Okay, and here is something that we can try out. So you say y equal to 0.1 times 3. So you expect that the result is 0.3. So if y is equal to 0.3, then let's have t. And if y is not equal to 0.3, then you say, let's, you know, launch a missile. So you would expect that y is 0.3. So, you know, peace will be ensured. But instead, you may see that you launch a missile. So let's try that out. So I'll just remove this and take, okay. So y equal to 0.1 times 3. And then say if y not equal to 0.3, so here you would expect that y is equal to 0.3. So y not equal to 0.3 will be false. So you'll have t's. Let's try to run it and see. So you see that you instead have war. Okay. So this is something that you should be careful when you deal with real numbers in Python. Had it been integer, 1 times 3, and you try to do this, then it will behave in a reasonable manner and you'll have peace. Okay. So when you deal with real numbers, which is 0.1, that, okay, so and then you say compare with 0.3, you will have behavior that is well defined and predictable, and it will always happen in a certain way, but it's not what the programmer expects from our experience in mathematics. So our experience in mathematics leads us to think in a certain way, but that's not how Python behaves. So let's just go back to the slides. Okay, so these are what are called floating point numbers. So representation of real numbers in any modern computer is never exact. A real number has infinitely many numbers in its representation, and there's no way for a computer to actually represent that. So it uses an approximation called floating point representation. So computers have limited memory to store data. And between any two distinct real numbers, there are any infinitely many real numbers. This is just a mathematical property. But on any typical machine, you cannot have infinite memory. So on a typical machine running Python, for example, there would be like 53 bits of precision available for a Python floating point number. So real numbers are not represented using infinite precision on any computer, including the Python programming language. So what you have are approximations. And because of approximations, going back one slide, because what you have are approximations, you cannot have exact comparisons. So the number you stored, so what happens in the previous example? So when you have a number like 0.1, it is internally stored in the decimal number 0.1 is internally stored in the binary representation, and the binary representation of 0.1 is actually fairly complicated. Here's an approximation of the representation here. So you have 0000, 11, and so on. So it's a fairly long representation. So this is the binary representation of the very simple decimal number 0.1. And because of this, what happens is that this is not exactly 0.1. This representation on in binary number in the binary representation is equal to the number like 0.1 followed by a lot of zeros followed by other numbers. So what the computer does in the Python language is to find the binary representation that is closest to the decimal number 0.1. And occasionally, and in the case of 0.1, it will never be the number 0.1 itself. There may be numbers for which the binary representation is exact, but 0.1 is not one of them. It will find the number that is closest to 0.1. But when you do that, what you have is an approximation of 0.1, and so you cannot do exact calculations with 0.1. So if you calculate 3 times 0.1, the representation will not be equal to 0.3. Okay, so no matter how many digits you use, as long as you use only finitely many digits, you only have an approximation to numbers. And this could cause problems for you. So how do you compare floats? Because of approximations, comparison between two floating point numbers is never exact. So how do you do this? So you don't compare two floating point numbers exactly. What you do is, you decide that I have an error parameter like epsilon, and within epsilon, if the numbers are close enough, so if the difference between these two numbers in absolute value is less than epsilon, then I'll say that the numbers are equal. So for example, my precision may be something like 10 to the power of minus 5. So up to the 10 to the power of minus 5 quantity, if I have two numbers x and y, and the difference between x and y is less than or equal to 10 to the power of minus 5, then I'll say that x equal to y. So this is, so when you have approximate representations, don't do exact comparisons with them. You just say that are they within a fairly close range of each other. So let's try to apply that principle in the code that we just saw. So instead of y not equal to 0.3, I'll say something like if absolute value of y minus 0.3 is less than or equal to some number that I like. Okay, so this is a number like 0.0001. If these two numbers are close enough, then I'll say that if these two numbers are different at this precision level, then I'll say that they are different. Okay. Otherwise, I'll say that they are same. So now I have more reasonable behavior. Okay. So you'll see that even though y is not precisely 0.3, y is sufficiently close to 0.3. So the difference between y and 0.3 is less than 0.0001. Okay. So they're sufficiently close numbers. Since they are sufficiently close numbers, I have peace. Okay, so this is how you would actually deal with floating point numbers. And please remember this, because this is true not just of Python, but any programming system that you will work with in your normal programming life. Whenever you deal with real numbers or floating point numbers, never do exact comparisons. What you do is decide what level of precision that you want. If two numbers are close according to that level of precision, then you just go ahead and say that they're equal. And when you do it in that way, you end up with the safe programs. Okay. So now let's introduce. So once we have logical operations, conditional expressions, if then else, let's now go to a slightly more sophisticated programming construct, which are called loops. And we will spend some time on the different loops in Python, because this is very important for any kind of programming. in Python. So let's motivate it with a very routine example that we have seen from school. Suppose you want to print the multiplication table of a particular number like 5. So what you will do is print 5 times 1 equal to 5, 5 times 2 equal to 10, and so on, until you are through with 5 times 10 equal to 50. Okay. So how would you do this in program? Okay, so what's the program supposed to do? It's supposed to take in a number n and then print the multiplication table for n. So from n star 1 all the way up to n star 10. Right now, the only way that we know how to do it is to have 10 lines of code saying n times 1 equal to something, n times 2 equal to something else, and so on. So we have to write 10 lines of code in order to print the multiplication table itself. One of the ideals motivating programmers is to never repeat themselves as far as possible. So for a programmer, it's an annoying thing if you have to write similar code again and again in your program. So the motive is to write short programs. And the question is, okay, what can enable us to do this? This is like, there's too much of repetition, and can I avoid repetition, repeating my code? Okay, so let's go back to a flowchart picture. So I have an input n, and then I start by saying that I equal to 1, and then if I is less than or equal to 10, so if I is already greater than 10, then I'll just stop. If I is less than 10, then I print n times I. Once I'm done with that, what I'll do is update I. So initially I equal to 1, then what I'll do is I'll do update I equal to 2, and so on. Okay. So if I do this 10 times, what I'll do is n star 1, n star 2, and so on. Okay, so what I do here is I start with I equal to 1, print n star I, update I to I plus 1, and then again check, okay, am I already above 10? If I'm not, I print update again and check again, and so on. Until at some point I'll exceed 10. At that point in time, I'll say that, okay, I've printed all the 10 multiples from n star 1 all the way up to n star 10, and then you can stop. So is there a way in which you can encapsulate the loop that you see in the flowchart, basically the cycle that goes from I less than or equal to 10 all the way back up? And this is what is called a loop in a programming language like Python. A loop has a few concepts associated with it. The initial line in the loop is called the loop entry. What you do after the loop is called the loop exit. And the circle itself is what is called the loop body or the loop. Okay, so now how do you do this in Python? So what you'll do is you initially read n. You take a number as input, convert it, cast it to int, and then start with I equal to 1. Now, the loop construct is what is called a while loop. So you say that while I is less than or equal to 10, so this is, as long as this condition is true, print n star I, do and after that do I equal to I plus 1, and then you go back into the loop. At some point I is actually greater than 10 and the while condition no longer holds, so you get out of the loop and then say print done. Okay, so the loop corresponds to this condition while I less than or equal to 10. And then you have two lines, and then you say, once the loop is done, you say the print done. Okay, so let's try that out. I'll do very simple print, and I put one after I print it. So this will update the number. And once I'm done, I'll just say, done. Okay, so just let's try to run this. So it's asked for enter the number, and let's say that I enter 5. And what it does is it prints 5 times 1, 5 times 2, so on up to 5 times 10. And then so basically it starts with while I less than 10, so initially I equal to 1. So it prints 5 times 1, then it changes I equal to 2. 2 is still less than 10, so it prints 5 times 2, which is 10. Then after that I becomes 3, goes back into the loop. 3 is less than 10, so it prints 5 star 3, which is 15, and so on. So when I equal to 10, it will print 5 star 10, which is 15. Update I to 11, and now 11 is not less than or equal to 10, so it just gets out of the loop and says done. Okay, so this is how a loop changes, a loop executes. Okay, okay. And so the while I equal to 10 colon up to I equal to I plus 1, that corresponds to the loop body that we saw in the earlier slide. So what is the general form of a while statement? So a while statement would have will be of the following form. It will have like while and then a logical expression. So it's a Boolean expression that evaluates to true or false. So whenever the condition is true, you execute the block of statements S1. And once the condition is false, then you go out of the loop and execute the block of statements S2. So evaluate the expression. If the expression is true, then executes S1. And again check back to S1. If the statement is false, then execute statement 2. So please notice the difference between the if condition, the way an if condition works, and the way a while loop works. In the case of an if condition, if the condition is true, then you execute S1 and you get out, right? Here, the difference is that when the condition is true, you execute S1, but then check back and say, is the condition still true? Okay, so this going back is what is different between a while loop and an if condition. In an if condition, you just check the condition once. In a while loop, you check the condition, you execute the statement, and again check the condition. Now, is it still true? Okay, if it is false, then execute statement true. So now let's look at a slightly larger example. Okay, so here I'll okay, so I'll just introduce the problem and then let's see how to write the code for this. Okay, so the problem is the following. Read a sequence of integers from the terminal until a minus one is entered. So minus one indicates that the input is now over, and output the largest numbers, that largest number that the user has input. And this may include the, this does include the minus one that the user has input. Okay. So first, let's think about the logic, then write the loop and add code for finding the largest. So here the operation is the following. You have to keep reading the input that the user keeps on entering. And the moment that the user enters minus one, you have to stop the process of reading the input. So okay, so the code looks in the following way. So for example, you read the first input, int input, so this will read the first number. And then you check whether the number is minus one. If the number is minus one, then your input is already over. If your number is not minus one, you have to read further numbers. So you again inside the loop, you read further numbers, and n equal to int input and so on. This is part of the logic for the code. Okay, so let's try this out. Okay, so int n equal to int. Input, and I'm not going to print any message, so it's empty braces. And then say while n is not equal to minus one, read more numbers. So n equal to int input. Okay, and this is all I'm going to do. I'm not even going to print or anything of that sort. So once I start running the program, I can run a number one, then a number two. Once I enter minus one, you can see that the program has essentially terminated. The cursor disappeared. Okay, so right now I'm not doing anything more with that. So for example, I could say print n. And so you can see like one, two, three, four, minus one, and then you enter the program. Okay, so this is how you would read numbers in a loop. And the program asks us to do something else as well. Okay, which is basically that once you read the input, you have to find the largest number read. Okay, so let's trace the loop. Okay, so at this point we have not added any code for finding the largest number of the loop of the user input. So let's just, this is just the loop to read inputs one after the other. So initially you read n equal to int input. So imagine that you have a variable n somewhere in your memory. And the user input is supposed to look like 4, 15, minus 5, and 1. Okay, so these are the inputs that the user is going to input. And let's see that what is the, at each state, what is the value of n? Initially, before executing the first input, n is just something unknown. After executing the first input, after executing the first line, it reads the first input and now n equal to 4. At this point, you do the comparison n not equal to minus 1, so that's true. So you get inside the loop and you read one more input. The next input is 15. Okay, so n becomes 15. Now 15 is not, so you go back to the while loop, and at this point 15 is not minus 1. Okay, so you again go in and you read the next input, which is minus 5. So you go back and you see that the last input is actually minus 1. Okay, so minus 5 is not minus 1, so you go in once more time and the last input is minus 1. So at this point, when you go back and check while n not equal to minus 1, n is actually now minus 1. So n not equal to minus 1 is false. Get out of the loop. Okay, so there is one call to input every time the body of the loop is executed. And every input reads one number and then casts it to integer. Okay. So here we have written one particular part of the logic, which is just reading a bunch of numbers. Now the code asks, the program asks us to do one more thing, which is to find the maximum number entered by the user. So how do we do this? Okay, so now in order to solve the problem in its entirety, what we do is we also keep track of what is the largest number that we have seen so far. Okay, so we have to find, ultimately we have to find the largest number entered by the user. But at every point, we can see that among the users among the users input that the program has read so far, this is the largest number. So we'll keep an integer variable called max, initialize it to some safe value like minus 1, because we know, like some safe value, maybe not minus 1, maybe some negative large, maybe some high negative value. Now, what do we do when we see a new number? There are two possibilities. So suppose our current maximum is minus 1 or minus 10,000 or something, some safe value. And now we see the number 4. So 4 is greater than minus 10,000. Okay. So the among the numbers we have seen so far, the largest value we have seen so far is 4. So we say that if max is less than n, if the current value of maximum is less than the number we have read, then clearly the new number is the maximum. So if maximum is less than n, then we say that max is reset to n. So you update max. And then you read the next number. Okay, so if n is minus 1 and so on, if n is minus 1, you're done. Otherwise, you update max and so on. Okay, so let's try to do this. So let's try to do this in code. So what I need to do is okay, let's put minus 1 and then so I read a number while n not equal to minus 1, and if max, which is the maximum number seen so far, so this is the maximum number seen so far, If the maximum number seen so far is smaller than n, then max is the number we just read. Okay. So this is how the loop is modified. And once the loop executes, we have processed all the numbers, then max will be the largest number that we have seen so far. Let's try that. So let's enter 415 minus 5 minus 1. This was, so it executed and the maximum number is 50. So what happens is when the first number is read 4, it goes inside the loop and says, So when the it goes inside the loop, and then it says that if max is less than n, max at this point is minus, and n is 4. So minus 1 is less than 4, so max becomes 4. Then you read the next input, which is 15. 15 is not minus 1, so you enter the loop. Max, remember, is 4 and n is 15. So 4 is less than 15. So you say max equal to 15. Then you read the next input, minus 5. It goes into the loop again. Max is 15, n is minus 5. 15 less than minus 5 is false. So max will not be updated. And then you read the next input, which is minus 1. And then you get exit. So correctly, the program would compute that. Correctly, the program would compute that the maximum is 15. Okay. So now I'll try to see. Okay, so what I guess can't launch a poll right now, but probably I'll launch it on chat. And this is just a question that you can think about, and people can, I guess, type in the answer. Can everybody see the poll, I guess? Can you see the can you see the chat? Yeah, okay, so okay, good. So I wanted the two confusing answers to come up, and somebody has entered that max will be minus one, and somebody else has said that max is not defined. Well, yeah, so if you follow the code, max of, okay, the output of the following code that I've entered will be minus one. Because if you look at line two of the code, then you can see that max is set to minus one, and then it will not even enter the while loop. So it will just print that max equal to minus one. But the answer nothing actually makes sense from a different perspective. So when the user input is essentially empty, then mathematically maximum is not defined. So the question was inside the code, what is being done? So the code does, it will be minus one. Now it's up to the programmer to see whether that's a reasonable thing. So mathematically, what you may want is something else. But as far as the code is concerned, the output will be minus one. I'm not necessarily saying that that is the right thing, but that's what the code does. For example, let's try that out. Okay. So I'll just run it and just enter minus one. And then it just says that the maximum number is minus one. But for example, if you have changed it to minus 10,000 or something like that, then when you run the code and you enter minus one, it just says that maximum number is 10,000. So it's not that it's computing some maximum on its own. Whatever is being given as the default value, it just prints that because it doesn't even enter the while loop. So it's up to the programmer to decide whether mathematically this is exactly what they want to do, or they want to define it in define the behavior in a different way. Okay, so I hope that's clear. Okay, so that's what I wanted to discuss for today. What we have seen in the lecture so far are arithmetic expressions, Boolean expressions, and once you have Boolean expressions, you have if then else, if elif, and so on. And then you have the notion of loops, where you basically want to repeat a certain task until certain things are true. A classic example in the case of cooking recipes, you may see a line like, you know, saute the onions till they are light brown or something like that. So that's a classic example of a while loop in action. So what it says is you do a certain operation, check whether a certain change has occurred. If not, do it again. If and the change has occurred, you stop the action and do something else. So that's what a loop is supposed to do. And we have seen one particular class of loops in Python, which are called while loops. In the next lecture, we'll see a more interesting class of loops, which are called for loops. So practically any for loop can be written as a while loop. But the thing is that for loops are easier to read for certain kinds of tasks. So in the next lecture, we will also see for loops. Okay, now next, so in the remaining 3 or 4 minutes in the lecture, I want to mention that there are graded assignments in the course. So even after the first lecture, there were assignments. I hope you have submitted them. Each assignment will be due 1 week after the lecture. So today's assignment will be due on February 7th, I think. 7th. So next Friday, I guess. And please make sure that, the way the assignments have been set up is that they'll be based on some small program. So you can code up the program in the Trinket. I'll add a link to the Trinkets. So you can code them up in the Trinket, try it out. And then based on the code, there'll be a question which you can answer. And in order to prevent people from just blindly guessing 4 choices again and again, the number of attempts will be limited. Okay, so if there are four choices, you may be given like three attempts. This is just to make sure that you do, just don't click A, B, C, D one after the other. Okay, somebody had a question. Okay, so I guess someone has a question about how many quiz questions were there. I think in the first week there were only one. There was only one graded quiz and there was an ungraded assignment, which you could just try out for practice. And the other was that can you resubmit an answer? You can resubmit an answer, but we have limited the number of attempts. So, for example, if you make a mistake, you can resubmit another answer. But we try to make sure that, for example, if there are four choices, you are given three attempts, so that there's an incentive for you to actually code it out and test it rather than just blindly clicking A, B, C, D. So I guess I hope that answers your question. So yeah, you can attempt a limited number of times, but that may not be unlimited. So it's not like you can try out as many times as you want, because then there is this thing that you don't even need to code. You can just click on the options and try to see what works. So in order to prevent that, we'll just, Okay, so in case you face any difficulties that you're unable to submit an assignment or it's not taking a resubmission attempt, please let us know, because there may be some configuration issues and we'll try to resolve. And so there may be a few configuration issues. If you let us know in time, then we can reopen the assignment, make an announcement so that everybody can resubmit and so on. So it will be good if anybody is facing difficulties to let us know by Wednesday or something of next week. Okay. So that's it. So I'll make an announcement to everybody in case you have issues. Please email at instructor@cats.org. Okay, my personal email is there are practice exercises on this chapter. Okay. There are also ungraded exercises that we have provided for practice. The graded exercises will be specially marked when you log in. Okay. So the ungraded exercises will be marked as ungraded. But in general, in general, please try out all the exercise problems. Okay. So in case you have any issues with resubmission, with submission deadlines, etc., please let us know. In general, we do not extend submission deadlines for reasons other than technical issues. So if there are some serious technical issues because of which nobody can submit their assignments and so on, then we'll try. But for individual things, we generally do not encourage extending the deadlines. So if you have if you're having troubles, please let us know by Wednesday or so, so that we can open the issue and everybody can submit by the deadline. Okay, so I hope you're having fun. So we'll see each other next week. In the meanwhile, if there are any issues, please email me at instructor@acads.org or at my personal email. I would prefer the instructor email because you know that way mails may not get lost as spam and so on. Okay, so that's it. Hope to meet you next week. Okay, have a great day. Bye.